In the bedmobile, jolting through Italy, I would type at the rear table, having made myself a pint of strong tea on the stove fed by nether gas tubes. The gift of concentration stays with me, and it is perhaps my only gift.
The full name is John Anthony Burgess Wilson, and there's a very simple reason for adopting the middle names for writing. I was in the colonial civil service in Malaya, and now Malaysia, I believe, and in general, one was not supposed to produce anything light-hearted, such as fiction, under one's own name. One was in a serious job. You could produce a monograph on local dialects or something like that, but you couldn't produce a novel. So I chose the two middle segments of the name and more or less stuck with them. I answer to any name you like, but sometimes Jack, sometimes John, but more often than not, my wife calls me Antonio. That's my name.
Anthony Burgess's work covers a wide range of narrative genre and historical periods. He rejects confinement in his writing as in his life.
The peculiar nature of the writer's life is that he is not anywhere. He is not like the sculptor who needs a studio, a big studio, and settles down there with his big masses of stone. He's a man with a typewriter and a wad of paper. And wherever he is, he wonders why he's there, why he's not somewhere else.
Burgess bought himself a camping car in which he travelled around Europe and beyond. He enjoyed living and writing in it. Anthony Burgess didn't begin his literary career until the age of 38. He published over 40 novels, including A Clockwork Orange and Earthly Powers. But a common theme ran through his multifaceted oeuvre: the observation of evil in contemporary society and throughout history. He was concerned about the issue of free will of individuals when faced with the choice between good and evil. This debate was at the heart of A Clockwork Orange that Stanley Kubrick adapted for the big screen in 1972. The film's success partially overshadowed the rest of Burgess's literary career. Anthony Burgess was born into an Irish Catholic family on the 25th of February 1917 in the industrial working-class city of Manchester in the north of England. He returned there in the 1980s with a British TV crew to revisit his childhood haunts.
You see, my mother, whom I never knew, had been a dancer and singer in the music hall. And my father was a pianist in the music hall and eventually a cinema pianist. I'm very proud of the fact that he played once for the Eight Lancashire Lads, which included Charlie Chaplin and Stan Laurel, Stan Jefferson in those days. This was a great tradition which has disappeared. We're a little too sedate, mechanized. I began my life in this city as a kind of orphan, in that at the end of the First World War, 1918, the influenza epidemic which ravaged Europe, ravaged this city particularly, and in 1 week my mother and my sister died. Indeed, my father came home from his barracks in Preston to find both my mother and my sister lying dead on the bed, on their respective beds, while I was gurgling in my cradle. I was obviously destined for something, God knows what, but for something.
Burgess, who was then known as John Wilson, was 5 years old when his father, Joe Wilson, announced to him in 1922 that he was to have a new mother. His father's second wife was Margaret Dwyer, landlady of the Golden Eagle pub. Burgess kept his childhood a closely guarded secret until 1986, when he published The Piano Players. In this book, he evoked his father's life as a pianist in pubs and music halls, and his own Dickensian childhood. He despised his stepmother and was neglected by his father. Burgess found his escape in music, an integral part of his childhood and of Mancunian life.
Well, these are at least the good old original industrial slums, bad plumbing, and between the blocks of houses, what we used to call entries, places where the cats roamed at night and screamed, cats' concerts, our only evening music, dustbins, sly copulation, but
Squalor, squalor. Why the hell did we put up with it, and why the hell is Manchester putting up with it now? This is just not worthy of man, especially Mancunian men.
Young Wilson was educated by the Catholic Brothers at the Xavierian College in Manchester. This was where he lost his regional accent.
I remember my childhood was a matter of being frightened of hellfire, frightened of sex, frightened of sensuality generally, and this fear of life was, of course, perhaps appropriate to the climate.
Burgess was a keen reader and was fascinated by Don Quixote. He already nurtured dreams of becoming a composer. Despite his Catholic-instilled fear, the young Wilson was sexually adventurous.
The great thing was to get to heaven if you could. Of course, Manchester helped. The weather always helped. The hard work always helped. The lack of colour and gaiety always helped. Get this life over as quickly as you could and get through, if you could, possibly, with a pass degree.
At the age of 16, he lost his Catholic faith. It was an event that had a profound effect on him.
When an Anglican loses his faith, it's a smooth and sweet process, rather like the shedding of a skin. His church has as good as told him not to take its doctrines too seriously. But for a cradle Catholic, to leave his church is like the wrenching of palpable bone and muscle. It's like the draining of the very contents of the skull.
All of Anthony Burgess's novels, all his great novels anyway, explore the question of evil, of good and evil. Although he lost his faith, he still explored this question from a Catholic viewpoint. Generally speaking, when a writer loses his faith, he tends to criticize the church, the religion he has left. But Anthony's work is characterized by this Catholic viewpoint, particularly from A Clockwork Orange onwards. What remained important for him from his faith and his Catholic education were the writers he admired, the writers whose style he adopted, the writers whose language he used were all Catholic. He had a particular admiration for James Joyce.
Burgess devoted 7 books to his favorite author. He also admired Shakespeare. In 1964, he published a novel called Nothing Like the Sun about Shakespeare's love life. After failing to gain entry to the Conservatory of Music, Burgess went to the University of Manchester in 1937 at the age of 20. He read English literature and phonetics, developing a passion for languages which was to remain with him all his life.
I remember as a boy going into the Central Library here just to read a dictionary. Just to swamp my sensibility with strange and beautiful words, which I was determined somehow to use in writing, as a composer would use the sound of an oboe, the sound of a glockenspiel.
During Burgess's time, university life was very much marked by the ongoing Spanish Civil War. Although there were a great many communist students, Burgess himself was not a Marxist and always refused to become politically involved. I was not really anything but a renegade Catholic liberal humanist with tendencies to anarchism.
One of the main reasons I admired Anthony Burgess was that he was never tempted by political solutions, nor was he swayed by utopian ideals. I believe he felt what Nietzsche termed profound pessimism. He certainly did not hold with the Marxist theory that it is possible to perfect man or society.
Anthony Burgess's father died. I got nothing and I wanted nothing. Anthony then met Luella Jones, a Welsh Protestant and political science student. They married when she was 18 and he was 22.
My first wife honestly believed that free, indiscriminate sexual congress was not a bad thing, because this prevented one from identifying with love. She said love was a different thing altogether. She may have been right, but we can't quite we can't so easily overcome our primitive instincts.
It was a relationship full of bitterness and infidelity on both sides. Burgess finished his degree in the autumn of 1940 against a backdrop of bomb raids and rationing. He asked to be sent to the front, but was assigned to a military hospital, and later transferred to a military band. The army finally sent him to Gibraltar as a teacher. It had been an inglorious war for me, a great deal of time wasted, and I had learned nothing. Anthony Burgess returned to civilian life in 1946, and after much searching, eventually found a teaching post at Banbury Grammar School in Oxfordshire. He spent every evening in the pub, and, convinced his future did not lie in music, he began to write. His first novel was published in 1953, A Vision of Battlements. It was an ironic novel drawing on his wartime experience of Gibraltar. This was quickly followed by The Worm and the Ring, a novel about life in a provincial grammar school.
Nobody had really celebrated the ordinary kind of state school. And I wanted to try and show what it was like to be in one of these places at that particular period in history. It was a period of cynicism for a lot of us. We were doing the job because we had to do the job, but we were cynical about it.
Burgess felt suffocated by his surroundings. One evening, a little the worse for drink, he applied for a teaching post in the British colonies. To his great astonishment, he was accepted. And so, in 1954, Burgess left Britain for a post at a teacher's training college in Malaya.
I was appointed to teach English at the Malayan Teachers Training College in Kota Baru in Kelantan. And after I'd been there about a year and a half, Anthony Burgess, who was then John Wilson, and his wife Lynn, joined our department. So he came to the college as a teacher of English, or lecturer, we called.
Kala.
If.
If. How do you say it?
If.
Again?
He was not a popular member of the staff. He did not join in the usual social activities, but it was a very cliquish place, and we were not in his clique and he wasn't in ours. But he didn't take any pains himself, nor did his wife, to endear himself to his new colleagues. He and Lynn pretty well established their own social circle in the town of Cota Baru, which was about 7 miles away. So we had the impression of John Wilson and his wife were both rather scandalous characters who got drunk and did outrageous things.
I used to sit in Kadai's like this when my schoolwork was finished and sketch my first novel. I called it Time for a Tiger, borrowing the slogan of the beer I drank while I scribbled.
The first manuscript that I believe set him on the road to being a writer was the one for Time for a Tiger. Now, it so happened that we were at the post office in this tiny northeastern town, Cota Baru, and John Wilson came out saying, "I've just posted my first manuscript."
Why this urge to record Malaya in fiction? Surely it had been done before, and very adequately, by William Somerset Maugham. True enough, but it was very much an outsider's Malaya, the planters and their wives, bridge in the club and adultery in the district officer's bungalow. The Chinese and the Indians were very shadowy figures,
and the Malays were reduced to a pair of obsequious brown feet on the veranda. However inadequate my own literary equipment might be, at least I got to know the people. Indeed, I got to know the Malays rather better than Joseph Conrad. I taught their sons. I spoke their language. I came here as a teacher, but I left as a writer. I'd never had any previous ambition as a maker of literature. Up to then, I'd been a sort of musician.
Burgess produced two other novels on Malaya, The Enemy in the Blanket and Beds in the East.
He observed the British Empire without making a particular stand. He never criticized the British for being empire builders or colonialists. He wrote about the many different societies in Malaya at the time, the Muslims, the Sikhs, the English, and the Tamils, in a pure comic style, in a very Shakespearean, very generous manner. Generous is a word which sums him up perfectly.
I was driven out of the colonial service, I think possibly for political reasons that were disguised as clinical reasons. My poor first wife was told that I had an inoperable cerebral tumour, and they gave me to cover themselves a year to live. She tried to keep the secret but could not, and eventually divulged it to me. I didn't feel too bad about it. I felt it was not true. In any case, I'd been given a year. I've not been given a year since.
After an absence of 6 years, Burgess returned to England at the end of 1959.
I sat down with a sense of duty to my my prospective widow and tried to make little money. It was very difficult. You could never make much money with writing to fulfill what talent I had and produce the works I did. It can be done. If you write 2,000 words before breakfast, you've got the rest of the day to yourself. And I did, in fact, produce very nearly 6 novels in that year.
Among the novels Burgess wrote that year was the first volume of the Enderby series, which brought him widespread recognition. He went on to write another 4 novels about his poet Enderby. Inside Mr. Enderby, published in 1963, Enderby Outside, published in 1968, The Clockwork Testament, or Enderby's End, in 1974, and the final volume in the series Enderby's Dark Lady, or No End to Enderby. Enderby is a tragicomic character, a misanthropic poet who writes while sitting on the toilet. The following, read by Burgess, describes Enderby's sexual indifference to his bride.
This from a book of my own, Inside Mr. Enderby, which describes Enderby's first fumbling attempts to consummate his marriage. This, he kept reminding himself, was his bride, an intelligent and desirable young woman, and it was time to be thinking of performing, that is to say, consummating, that is to say. He stealthily felt his way down to find out what was his body's view of this constatation, but all was quiet there, as though he were calmly reading Jane Austen. I feel that women writers would not like to approach sex in that manner. They're too deeply involved. It is not fun to them. It is not something comic. It is something deadly serious.
1, 2, 3 o'clock, 4 o'clock, rock. 5, 6, 7.
The following year, Burgess wrote the novel A Clockwork Orange, the tale of teenage Alex who spends his time murdering and raping with his fellow gang members.
This was the point when rock and roll hit the scene. The first rock and roll riot was at the Trocadero at the Elephant and Castle. This was followed by similar demonstrations all over the country. Again, the nation was up in arms.
Burgess saw danger in the new consumer society of teenagers, which appeared in the late 50s. He was also worried by the violence of the gangs of young Teddy Boys and of their successors, the Mods and the Rockers, who frequently clashed. With A Clockwork Orange, Burgess wanted to produce a futuristic novel, and so he set it in the 1970s and thought up a new language for his characters.
There was me, that is Alex, and my three droogs, that is Pete, Georgie and Dim. Dim being really Dim. And we sat in the Corova milk bar, making up our rusadox what to do with the evening. Our pockets were full of deng, so there was no real need, from the point of view of Crastin, any more Pretty Polly, to tall-chock some old Vec in an alley and vidy him swim in his blood while we counted the take-ins and divided by four.
Burgess invented his own slang, nadzat, rather than use contemporary Cockney rhyming slang, because it was a way of disconnecting the novel in time, of giving it a futuristic sound. Nadzat is the combination of two languages, Russian and English. Burgess took Russian words and mixed them with English to create a new language full of bilingual puns.
For me, A Clockwork Orange is a work of tremendous courage. Although I was unaware of it when I read the novel for the first time, I later learnt that he had written it because his first wife had been a victim of a rape.
Apparently his wife Luella, or Lynn as he called her, was attacked one night in London by a group of young men. They raped her and she consequently lost the baby she was carrying at the time. She never fully recovered from the ordeal, and that was Burgess's first wife. In fact, she never got over it, and Burgess suffered terribly as a consequence. I believe Lynn became an alcoholic as a result of the rape.
He could well have written about his own feelings, his own pain, his own sadness. But he chose not to. Instead, he imagined a character, the hero of A Clockwork Orange, and made him as charming as he could. Anthony Burgess even gave his hero the thing dearest to him, the pleasure, the pure pleasure he felt for music, and most especially for the works of Beethoven.
I've always wondered whether writing this novel wasn't a form of atonement for Burgess, because he had been unable to prevent his wife from becoming an alcoholic. He was a very complex man, you know. Very complex indeed.
One cannot help feeling disgust when reading the novel. Evil is evil, and it is presented as evil. The evil of the teenagers and the evil of society are depicted as such. Although I believe a writer would be justified in saying that society is more violent than the perpetrators of violence. This is not what Burgess intended. He wanted to show that man himself is essentially evil.
A Clockwork Orange did not sell well. Short of money, Anthony Burgess became a literary critic for a number of newspapers and magazines. He worked as a critic right up until the end. Several collections of his reviews have been published, notably Homage to Quirt Uiop in 1986. He also produced several biographies of writers.
He would have been a brilliant journalist had he done only that. He tried to really understand literary works. There is a long tradition in England of our best critics also being accomplished writers. T.S. Eliot or Coleridge, for example. Oh, the same is true of France, where Marcel Proust understood Flaubert better than an ordinary critic. I think Burgess used writers like Coleridge or Proust as a model for his own work.
In 1964, to facilitate his work as a journalist, Burgess bought a house in South London. But he scarcely had time to write novels, as he also produced television, opera, and theatre reviews. Terry Sutton, a taxi driver, was one of Burgess's only friends. He was also witness to the very dark period in the writer's private life when Lynn became a chronic alcoholic. Gradually, a close friendship developed between the two men.
He works for a newspaper, he reviews the opera, but he knew the operas off by heart, who was in them and where they used to stand almost, at Covent Garden. And as he used to know them, he used to say to me, well, you can go in my place and I can stay at home and write. So, all you got to do is let us know if anything happens, if someone falls off the stage or something catches fire. And it was great because I see Tito Gobi and Mary Callas. I see all the operas down there, all three in Covent Garden, all down to John Burgess.
This is how Burgess found the time to write two more novels, Honey for the Bears and Tremor of Intent. Both are satires of spy novels.
The pubs that you used to visit, on Saturday morning used to be a regular, which is this one coming around here now. If you have someone that's an alcoholic and gets violent and really insults people, maybe that's why I like coming out on Saturday mornings for a drink on his own sort of thing, nice walk.
His wife Lynn died of cirrhosis of the liver in 1968. Burgess had just turned 51. In a day or two, there was nothing of her left, but it is not easy to be wholly rid of the dead. I heard her creak in the rocking chair, a nervous cough in the room above. I wept. Then Liana Marcelli, the daughter of an Italian countess, turned up in his life again. He had previously had a brief affair with her in London. She told him that he had a 4-year-old son called Paolo Andrea. Burgess was very proud of his son and married Liana in the autumn of the same year.
It wasn't a van simply for camping. It was a van for traveling around the world. It was ideal for travelers because it had everything. It was like a house on four wheels. The van was fitted out with all mud cons. It was perfect for us. You see, there were even plenty of bookshelves and a little bar as well. It was as if we were really at home, except that we took to the road whenever we felt like it. And the van was always parked, overlooking the most beautiful views of all Europe. I liked the way he traveled all over Europe in his Dormobile. He was a bohemian, a traveler, a troubadour at heart. I believe he found immense pleasure in being free to roam the world, in being a traveler. We all feel the need for both these things, of being free to travel and being settled. He was very fortunate as a writer to have roots that did not oblige him to remain in one place.
They spent 1 year in Malta, but their house was confiscated by the new government. So they took to the road again, later settling in Rome. Drawing inspiration from the myth of Oedipus and Levi Strauss's work on incest, Burgess produced his novel M.F.
You shake my nerves and you rattle my brain. Too much of love drives a man insane. Broke my will, but what a thrill. Goodness gracious, great balls of fire. I let you love what I thought it was.
along and woo, now, honey, I've changed my mind. This love is fine.
Hollywood had bought the rights to A Clockwork Orange in the 1960s. In 1970, while he was on the road, Burgess learnt that Stanley Kubrick was making a film of it.
He was absolutely not involved with the film at all. Stanley didn't like any fraternization by another artist at all. So, you know, I used to ask about Anthony Burgess. My God, you know, forget it. Oh, we don't want to, you know, I don't want him around. My God, you know. I always carried Anthony Burgess's novel with me, the book, and would go through the passages and underline things that were relevant to the scenes that I was doing. And a lot of it's cribbed right from the book.
As he had not been credited, Burgess altered the poster for A Clockwork Orange by replacing Kubrick's name with his own. Kubrick later sent Malcolm McDowell and Burgess to the United States to collect some awards. This was Burgess's only involvement with the film.
Anthony and I went to America, to New York. He stayed at the Algonquin Hotel because that's where all the great writers stayed, you see. And I had the most wonderful week with him because he was one of the greatest raconteurs I've ever heard. And in fact, it was a lot of fun. We were there supposedly to go and pick up awards from the New York film critics. And Anthony was picking up on behalf of Stanley Kubrick. Anthony Burgess stood up and said, well, I have been sent by God, Stanley Kubrick, to pick up this award. And of course, everybody just fell about, you know.
On its release in Great Britain and the United States, the film caused a great scandal and was seen as the trigger for numerous acts of violence. Kubrick withdrew the film from distribution in England, and it has not been shown there since. Anthony Burgess himself was blamed for inciting murder. The film plagued him for the rest of his life.
I became associated with violence chiefly because of the film, and if a couple of nuns were raped in Berwick-on-Tweed, I would always get a telephone call from a newspaper, you know, Mr. Burgess, what do you think of this? Do you not feel in some measure responsible? Stanley, they would never telephone you, Stanley, because you keep out of the way. And I've had to deal with this all over the world.
Yeah.
So in consequence, they've turned me into a kind of expert on violence, which I really know nothing about.
And I remember when it opened, the film, there were editorials from the sort of liberals, you know, about... because they couldn't help kind of like the character, but there he was, raping and beating and God knows what else. And you end up feeling sorry for him. Because you only end up feeling sorry for him because the bigger issue is the right to choose. And to choose, even though he's bad, let him be bad, rather than alter his brain and make him into an automaton. And I think that's what the whole thing is about, and that's what Burgess wrote. And he wrote it brilliantly and disguised it in a brilliant story.
He was heavily inspired by George Orwell's 1984, even though in that book everything was under the state's absolute control and individuals were victims of the state. But the image of the state in A Clockwork Orange is, nevertheless, very reminiscent of 1984. And when the year 1984 arrived, Burgess wrote a book called 1985, featuring groups of young freedom fighters resisting the grip of the totalitarian state and learning Latin in secret. Latin plays the same role as Beethoven. It is something beautiful which attracts young people because it is forbidden.
In 1974, Burgess wrote The Clockwork Testament, in which his poet Enderby is pursued by the effects of a film for which he does not feel responsible. Burgess was bitter because he had only been paid $500 for the film rights to A Clockwork Orange, and Kubrick had omitted the final chapter of the book, where Alex renounces violence and intends to start a family. However, the film turned the novel into an international bestseller, which was translated into many different languages. The cinema industry commissioned many film scripts from Burgess, all of which became novels.
He never stopped writing scenarios.
Indeed, one of the most attractive sides of Burgess, one of the most appealing things about his mind, was that if you threw an idea at him, and he liked it, you immediately sensed his brain whirring into action, and he would have the beginnings of a plot in his mind. As soon as he liked an idea, for example, when Kubrick spoke to him about Napoleon, he was absolutely delighted, and he produced a script called Napoleon Symphony. However, the film was never made, and so he took all the basic elements and he reworked them to produce a novel. He also wrote the script for Zeffirelli's Jesus of Nazareth and later made a novel of that too. It was published in France as L'Homme de Nazareth and later appeared in England under the title of Christ the Tiger. The novel told the story of Christ's life. It's a fascinating, brilliant work.
Burgess settled in Monaco in 1976 and remained there until his death.
I'm not wealthy being a writer, but one has to live somewhere, and to go into the reasons why I'm there would take too long, but the fact is I was living in Italy with my wife and our son was going to be kidnapped. I was told this by an ex-mafioso, and so we got into the car and ran to the next state, which happens to be Monaco. Simple as that.
I think what Burgess liked about Monaco was the fact it was small and postmodern. He viewed it as a parody of a royal kingdom.
In 1978, Burgess was contacted by the French film director Jean-Jacques Annaud to invent the language to be used by the primitive men in his film Quest for Fire. It was the afternoon of my 81st birthday, and I was in bed with my catamite when Ali announced that the Archbishop had come to see me. This is the opening sentence of Earthly Powers, in which Burgess's narrator, a homosexual writer, tells the tale of a pope who unwittingly becomes an agent of evil. The story unfolds over the entire 20th century.
All the battles the Pope wins are earthly battles, not battles with an infernal power. This is why Burgess chose to call it Earthly Powers. He loses almost all the spiritual battles he undertakes. Evil is triumphant. Although people try to prevent Hitler's rise, they are powerless. A child's life is saved, but at the same time, a murderer is spared. Although the vision expressed in this novel is extremely dark, Earthly Powers has a ferocious energy which, in a sense, is the triumph of evil over everything. Except over art. Art cannot be destroyed.
I still regard the writing of fiction as a kind of substitute for the writing of symphonies. But I tend to approach the novel as one would approach a work of music. One doesn't have the agony of ruling the bar lines and penciling in the notes, but one has the necessity of discovering certain motifs which reappear, which can be developed, certain auditory puns which are analogous to music. But at the end, I discover that I am more of a composer manqué than a genuine writer.
Burgess never stopped composing. Towards the end of his life, he had great success adapting musicals. These included a new version of A Clockwork Orange in 1990 and a number of opera librettos like Weber's Oberon, which was performed at the Fenice in Venice.
music was written for me by my father in 1990. And it's a sonata for great bass recorder. And my father wrote for it when I explained that no sonatas existed. And he wrote three in all.
Was he a good father?
Well, first, can anybody tell me what a good father is? He was excellent no matter how busy. Worried or whatever, he'd still manage to be there and do something for me. For example, I think I was 10 years old, or around that, and I fell in love with this girl. And at 5 o'clock in the morning, before getting my 6 o'clock train, I was banging on my parents' bedroom door and asked my father to write a song, which he promptly did. So, if somebody is working till midnight, 1 o'clock, and has a son banging at the door at 5 o'clock in the morning wanting a song, I think there's not much more you can ask.
Have you read the autobiography? And what did you think of it?
Well, something I liked about the autobiography was that before it was published, it was kept in a safe, in case I decided I didn't like it and would destroy it. Well, there was nothing to destroy anyway, but I'm baffled that somebody can remember so many details. Addresses, dates. Pretty incredible. And at the same time, most of what's written on me is completely wrong.
Hell. Hell is a straight and dark and foul-smelling prison, an abode of demons and lost souls filled with fire and smoke.
I still fear hell, rather more than infinite space, because no amount of intellectual reduction can quite get rid of that tradition. It may exist. As I get closer to death, I fear hell more. Hell exists.
The inscription on Anthony Burgess's tombstone, ABBA, comes from the title of his novel, Abba Abba. I think this is my probably favourite pun or witticism of Burgess. Abba, Abba is what Christ said on the cross. Abba, Abba.
Abba, Abba.
O Father, Father, why hast thou forsaken me? Also for Burgess, it represented the form of a sonnet. A-B-B-A, A-B-B-A. And if you look at the cover of his novel, Abba Abba, you see that AB stands for Anthony Burgess.